Thanks very much, Program Director. MEC Mabuyokulu, let me welcome your reappointment as well. Speaker of the Etiquette Municipality, Councillor Logie Naidu, international experts and guests who are present, members of the Durban Automotive Cluster who are here, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege and a pleasure to be able to share a few words with you this morning. And you asked me to speak about the policy environment for the automotive sector, which I will reflect on, but I'm going to also try to zoom in a bit at the end on the main theme, which I think is a very important theme that you've chosen, which is localization. Before I start to speak, I just want to reflect on the commercial that Councillor Logie Naidu gave, and just to say that without having heard his commercial, I have in fact over the last 5 years, my official cars have been Toyota Fortuners. I have one in Cape Town and I have one in Gauteng, and let me say that I took that decision precisely for the reasons that you say. I wanted a South African manufactured vehicle to be my official vehicle. And I have had a great pleasure driving that car for the last 5 years. I've had no problems with that model, so I think it is a testimony to your cabinet. Let me start off with just a few points about the strategic significance for the automotive sector in South Africa. I think the point has already been made by MEC Mabuyokulu that the automotive sector contributes between 6 and 7% of the gross domestic product of South Africa. But if we look at the contribution to manufacturing output in this country, the percentage becomes very much more significant. In fact, it's 30%. So the automotive sector is the biggest sector in manufacturing in South Africa. It also has very, very important linkages both upstream and downstream to at least 6 or 7 other industrial subsectors in South Africa. And it sustains service operations estimated at something around 200,000 jobs in after-sales services as well as sales themselves. So the automotive sector is very important in our manufacturing space. And as you may have picked up even from the CV, what we have seen as a policy priority in South Africa is that we need to up the scale of industrialization in this country. We cannot any longer hope to continue to live, prosper, create jobs and sustainable livelihoods for our people if we remain entrapped in the global division of labor as producers and exporters of primary products and importers of value-added products. As long as we stay there, we will be battling over the distribution of resource rents, and we will not be taking our economy further forward. This is a proposition which has now become common cause, not just in South Africa, but in fact across the African continent. The entire African continent is coming very rapidly to the conclusion that the next phase of African growth and development has got to involve industrialization. Now, a little while ago, I participated in the World Economic Forum in Abuja, Nigeria. And somebody who was there from KPMG in London gave some figures of a study that they had done in KPMG. And I think it's not really terribly new, but I think the figures tell us an important story. And according to this gentleman, KPMG had calculated that Africa earns from the production and export of coffee $6 billion. But that African coffee has further value added to it outside of the borders of Africa. And in fact, the total is $100 billion. So from $6 billion of African coffee, $100 billion of income are earned outside of the borders of Africa. Another example they gave is that I think closer to home, Italy earns more from the manufacture of jewelry than South Africa does from the production and export of gold. So I think that's the sort of story that tells us why value addition is critical and important. And of course, as I've already tried to make the point, within the framework of the existing industrial economy of South Africa, and of course there are many other sectors that we are trying to support and push further forward, including industrial subsectors directly linked to our infrastructure program, which is fundamental, a whole range of capital goods, transport equipment and so on. But in addition, and as a fundamental component of our manufacturing, the motor industry is of critical and significant importance. And I want to say as well is that over the last 5 years, as we emerged from the recession of 2009, but the recession, of course, caused by the global economic crisis, as we emerged from that, it was investments by automotive manufacturers, supported by the automotive investment scheme, that actually led the recovery in the manufacturing sector. We had lost 200,000 of the million jobs in manufacturing. 20% of the jobs we lost were in manufacturing in 2009. Now, manufacturing is 12% of the GDP, even less. So what we had lost is we'd lost proportionately more jobs in manufacturing than we lost in the economy as a whole. And I think we had the very real risk that we would have gone through a phase of serious deindustrialization over the last 5 years. And I think that we've avoided that. And our industrial policy action plans, I think, have achieved some degree of stability in some of the subsectors. And the automotive sector, as I say, led the way with some very, very significant investments by the OEMs. Driven, I think, and supported by the automotive investment scheme, which is a component of the automotive production and development program, but in fact we front-loaded it. We brought forward the application of the AIS before we had achieved the transition from the MIDP to the APDP, which has now been achieved. So I think that that is a significant factor. Let me say, if we look back over the last 20 years or so, I think that the MIDP and the APDP, but mostly the MIDP, of course, if we're covering this period, what we have actually managed to achieve, I think, is a very important structural change in the nature of automotive manufacturing in this country. Before the transition to democracy in South Africa, also I suppose in the context of sanctions and embargoes and whatever, we had a large number of models with extremely short runs, producing only for the domestic market, and within the domestic market, only for really for the white minority to a very large extent in the domestic market. We had a small market serviced by a large number of brands dependent on ever-increasing, very, very high tariff rates. And I think what we've achieved is we've achieved an integration of automotive production into global value chains. So what we are no longer doing is just producing automotive products for the local market. We are producing for the local market and also for exports, and a growing range, as I'm going to indicate in a moment, of destinations in international markets. We've achieved that very, very important shift, while at the same time being able to achieve a higher volume of production and a higher level also of component manufacturing. So I think a few figures just to show what has happened will tell us the story. In 1995, the capital expenditure by OEMs in South Africa was 847 million rand, and in 2012, it was 4.7 billion rand. So we've seen that there's been a very substantial increase there. Export values in 1995 were 4.2 billion rand, and in 2012, they were 86.9 billion rand. The total number of vehicles or units that were exported was 15,000 in 1995, and it was 278,000 in 2012. The productivity measured by the average number of vehicles produced per employee was 10 in 1995 and 18.5 in 2012. The number of destinations for vehicles and components exported was 62 in 1995 and 152 in 2012. And the total number of vehicles produced was 389,000 in 1995 and 539,000 in 2012, with the number of vehicles sold being about 400,000 in 1995 and 624,000 in 2012. So I think that we can see that the industry has made progress across a range of indicators over the last 20 years, and that transition that we have made is an important one. And it has meant, among other things, that we are producers of, we are highly competitive producers of motor vehicles. Our plants, I mean, for example, I was just down at the opening of the largest single automotive investment in South Africa in recent years, the Mercedes new C-Class line in East London a few weeks ago. And of course, that plant last year received the J.D. Power's Silver Award for the best automotive exports into the United States. 2 years earlier, they won the Platinum Award. That's one example, I think, among others, that our automotive production capabilities as a country are quite considerable. So where have we been trying to go in policy? What is the direction and the way forward as we see it? Well, I think that everybody here knows, and I've already said it, that the main focus of our policy development over the last few years has been the transition from the Motor Industry Development Program to the Automotive Production and Development Program, with us fast-tracking one part of the APDP even before that transition was complete, namely the Automotive Investment Scheme. The APDP is designed with a slightly different architecture to the MIDP. The MIDP basically rewarded exports. Now, there were a number of reasons why we wanted to move from rewarding exports to rewarding value added in this economy. But that's the fundamental change that's taken place. The support program is based on rewarding and incentivizing greater value added in this economy. Number of reasons, some of them to do with the potential vulnerability in international fora of a program which was directly supporting exports. But the second one is that I think that by focusing on value added in this economy, that actually is really what it's about. It's about creating more productive capacity in this economy and underpinning much more secure and quality jobs in South Africa. The essence of the APDP is built on four levers. There's a stable import tariff. I think we have concluded that what we need is we need a moderate level of protection, but not a level of protection that we envisage declining anytime soon. So we want to say there's a moderate, stable level of protection in South Africa, 25% for CBUs and 20% for CKD components. The second element is the Vehicle Assembly Allowance. Manufacturers with a minimum plant volume of 50,000 units, and by setting this minimum, actually, what we did see was we saw a number of OEMs making investments precisely to try to reach that minimum threshold, and they can get a percentage of their components duty-free, 20% of components decreasing to 18% over 3 years. Then there's a production incentive, which is an allowance permitting duty-free imports of vehicles or components calculated at 55% of the value added in the South African supply chain, reducing to 50% over 5 years, with a special dispensation for vulnerable industries. That was one of the things that we found. There was a number of subsectors which had, the one that's best known, of course, is catalytic converters. where there were high volumes of exports but very low value addition. And so the shift in the architecture meant that that was an anomaly which we tried to address to a degree as much as we thought we could. And then there's the automotive investment scheme, which is a cash grant of 20% of the investment value with an additional 5 and 10% benefit subject to the OEMs meeting, in particular the OEMs, but also the component manufacturers benefit from this, also meeting targets in terms of employment, localization, and so on. Let me say, what are some of the directions we've been trying to move in terms of building further on this policy? I think the first one was that we have sought to move in the direction also of supporting not just passenger vehicle manufacturing, but also medium commercial heavy vehicles. And then also in the medium term, we're looking to support also electric vehicle manufacturing in this country. So on the front of the medium and heavy commercial vehicles, we've done a number of things. First of all, and this is a tool of localization, is we have designated bus bodies that are on buses procured by municipalities. We have designated these for procurement has to be from local manufactured sources. As late as the FIFA World Cup, the buses that were procured for the FIFA World Cup were not covered by this designation, and almost all of them were 100% fully imported. But what we have done since then is we've introduced this designation, and buses which are now being procured, even from international companies, buses which are now being procured for bus rapid transits, public transport systems in municipalities, are now all beginning to have bus bodies locally manufactured. The second thing is that we extended the automotive investment scheme to include a package for people's carriers. And I was here to launch the one here in Toyota, the Quantum Sesfikili production line. There were quite a few years when we were not manufacturing taxis that were fully imported. Now minibus taxis are being manufactured in South Africa, benefited from this program. We've increased the PI support for components on a higher level. We have widening, we are in the process of widening the support of the APDP into the area of agricultural and yellow metal industries. So another industry here in KwaZulu-Natal, which is Bell and also Desi, would benefit from this. We are incentivizing higher levels of localization and component manufacturing and R&D support. And we're looking to widen the distribution and after-sales support in regional markets. I'm going to come and talk about what I think are some of the challenges of us repositioning ourselves in the African continent in a minute. But I think that what we are pretty clear about is that the African continent needs to be looked at increasingly as a place where we can expand our operations. We have a roadmap for electric vehicles based on, I think, the very clear indication that environmental concerns will infuse this industry, and that South Africa needs to find itself not in the position where we are making the gas guzzlers of the world when everybody else is making something else. And I was quite surprised, I mean pleasantly so I think, but I think it shows us something of the challenge. When I went last year to the Johannesburg International Motor Show, and I hadn't been for 2 years, and I went 2 years before, and there were a number of exhibitions of energy, alternative energy, electric or hybrid vehicles in the 2 years ago, 3 years ago. But when I went last year, everyone had one. Everyone has a model. They are developing, if they haven't got it out already, a model of some or other electric vehicle, and I think we have to bear that in mind. Then we are supporting the a development of a multi-model OEM plant in East London to bring together a number of smaller players so they can combine their operations. And then I think very importantly, we have sought to complement the support programs which we provide as government with an initiative which is an initiative of the industry, the unions and government together, which is the Automotive Supply Chain Competitiveness Initiative. I think we've recognized and realized, all of us, and I think that it's very important that all players have come on board on this, that we need to collaborate to raise the competitiveness of the South African manufacturing industry. Let me say that as we move ahead, what do we need to achieve? Well, I think the mandate that we received as the government, certainly the kind of mandate which is being directed at me and the DTI, is that while we have seen some results and some progress from our industrial policy measures, we have at least averted a serious threat of deindustrialization over the last 5 years. We have shown that we're carefully crafted, well-designed, these measures can have some success. We have not yet really made sufficient headway in placing our economy on a qualitatively different growth path, one which is increasingly led by diversified value-added economic activities. We're not yet there. So we have to make a bigger leap in that direction in the life of this administration. Now, I think we've said that there are a number of key levers that we need to identify. Some of them don't really fall in this space, but I'll just mention them. They are minerals beneficiation and add value addition to our agricultural products. We've actually got to just do this. The second one is that we need to position ourselves and reposition ourselves in this Africa continent. In the continent, we are, well, the figure was mentioned, we are only 1% of world trade, but world production rather, but we are the leader by far on the African continent. But the rest of the African continent, many countries, are also looking to the automotive sector as an industry that they want to industrialize off. And I think that, let me just mention a couple of examples. Some of our partners in the Southern African Customs Union are clearly looking to become component manufacturers providing inputs into the South African automotive value chain. And why shouldn't they? They are obviously in our customs union with us, and that is a reasonable ambition and expectation from them. Are we going to get ourselves into a zero-sum game where a component manufacturer is either in South Africa or in one of their countries? Or are we going to move ourselves further forward up the supply chain, where perhaps some of the lower tiers of component manufacturing migrate to their countries, but that we move higher up the component manufacturing value chain in South Africa, and particularly we focus and specialize on components which through things like supplier parks are best located geographically very close to the actual OEM manufacturing operation. It's one challenge. Secondly, we've got a country like Nigeria, which has defined industrialization as absolutely critical for its own future and is looking to learn a great deal from the South African automotive program. There have already been a number of technical exchanges with them, looking to that to develop a similar program to ours. Now, here's the challenge, and I know that some of the OEMs are well aware of it. We have said to the Nigerians, and we know where Nigeria is at, they're going to be doing SKD manufacturing, and they're going to be doing it, they're probably 40 years behind the South African industry. Where are the components for the SKD manufacturing going to come from? It's not automatically that they're going to come from South Africa, even if the brands are the same. Can the South African manufacturers, OEM manufacturers, position themselves so we can become suppliers of Nigeria? And here, I've thrown the ball to some of them. There's a couple of companies, I won't mention them, but at least one of them comes from here. Come and tell us. Come and tell us what it will take. Do we need a company level agreement? Do we need to negotiate a PTA with Nigeria? What is it that we need to put in place, because we have some possibilities of doing that, so that the supply of the inputs into the Nigerian motor manufacturing industry comes from here. And I think this is about repositioning ourselves on the African continent. There'll be many, many other issues about it which are not in other industries. So I'm just mentioning those. And then let me just, to make the other point, which I want to make, the last point I want to make, about the importance of the theme which you've addressed here today of localization. And I want to make this point by reference to some figures which I think are worth taking note of about the impact of the automotive investment scheme from its inception until the 31st of March this year. The AIS supported 193 projects with a total investment value of 22.5 billion and created because without these investments they wouldn't exist, 9,756 jobs. That was what the AIS achieved. But when we break this down, 16 of the 193 projects were OEMs, original equipment manufacturers. They invested 17 of the 22.5 billion and they created 2,677 of the 9,000 jobs. Component manufacturers, on the other hand, there were 177 projects approved. The investment value was 5.5 billion, roughly a third of what it was for the OEMs. But the jobs created were 7,079, which is roughly nearly three times as many jobs as were created by the OEMs. Now, that's not to say that the OEMs' presence is not important, because without the OEMs, the component manufacturers wouldn't be here. But what it is to say is that the OEMs, the platforms of the OEMs, can support component manufacturers making smaller investments and creating many more jobs. That's what it says. So when we talk about localization, I think that localization, a lot of the discussion, I'll say the whole thing because there can be all sorts of things about how we purchase and, you know, whether we take decisions like the one I took and spread this around, all sorts of things like that, how we support buy local and all that. But the big thing, one of the big things in localization, is getting more component manufacturing in South Africa. I think that's what it's about. How do we get more component manufacturing? Now, some of the instruments, and I've already mentioned this, are to try to encourage that. So the bigger support packages in the automotive investment scheme are around that, and we've seen some of this happening. We've seen, for example, Volkswagen increased its percentage local content from something about 40% to something about 60% in the Polo. Now, that's the sort of thing that can happen. We've been trying to encourage it incrementally, progressively, and so on. But I'm also aware that there's a discussion going on about whether there could be a big, if you want to use the term, radical leap forward in localization and component manufacturing. That we would take a decision that we would produce some unit that we are not producing in South Africa at this point in time, and that this would increase localization, not just incrementally, but with a big leap forward. Let me say that we would be extremely interested in relating to any proposals of that sort. If there were proposals of that sort that were able to identify some new unit manufacturing that could take place in this country, let us hear all the things that would need to fall together to make that possible, and let us see what we can do as a DTI and as government to make that happen. Because I think that what I'm trying to say is that we need to strengthen our component base. We need to strengthen and deepen our component base even by moving higher up the value chain than we have been up to now. Or not that we haven't been there at all, but we need to be more up there than we've been there up to now. And that this is going to be, I think, the way forward for the automotive industry. So our overall perspective is one where we see an importance for taking manufacturing up that notch. And this is an important subsector of manufacturing, and it is our commitment to build on our policy frameworks, to work with you. And so I look forward to the outcome and the results of this particular Indaba. And if there are concrete proposals, we will be more than happy to entertain any proposal which is going to take us to higher levels of localization and higher levels of component manufacturing in this country. Thank you very much.